Hello, how you doing today, David?
Good.
Excellent, excellent. For those of you watching, my name is Jeff Agostenilli from Health Happens Naturally, and I am here with David Favor, the founder of Sunfire Superfoods and Radical Health. Pretty powerful there, Radical Health.
Woo-hoo! Let's get radical, buddy.
Cool. So today's topic, we are going to get into SSRIs, selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors, and MAO inhibitors, or MAO inhibitors.
Yeah.
Yes, which are monoamine oxidases. I had to look at my notes for that one. So, the way we got into this conversation was just with all of the kids in our world today on different kinds of, Ritalin, Adderall, all the pill-popping culture, so to speak. I was speaking with David yesterday and I said, dude, let's just do an interview on this so we can just bring some light to the situation and offer some solutions. So here we are today, and we're going to begin by David just offering some light in the conversation about what exactly SSRIs are and MAO inhibitors as well. So
thank you for being here,
David, and just go right into it, brother.
Yeah, well, we were talking about this a little bit before we started up about the difference between Eastern and Western sort of approaches.
Yes.
So the Western approach to health situations is, you pay no attention to your external environment or internal environment. And you just take out a big hammer and back when I lived in the woods, we called them cheater bars. If there was a nut rusted and you couldn't turn it with a wrench, that just mean you had a cheater bar that was too short. A cheater bar is a big long pipe you put on a wrench to get more leverage.
Yeah.
Right? The problem with that is if something's rusted tight and you put too big a cheater bar, you may twist the head off, and then you got to drill that lug out of that wheel hub or whatever it is you're trying to get out. That's the Western approach, though. The Western approach is you just, beat it over the head until, something gives and a good idea. So the Eastern approach is a little bit different. Instead of trying to interrupt or artificially manipulate, you feed.
Yes.
In other words, you feed a gland or an organ. And if the living environment your body is in is too harsh, then instead of trying to beat it up with a crowbar or a hammer, you move someplace where it's more conducive to your particular biological equipment.
Mm.
So, for example, if you're, you live up north where it's cold and dark all the time, and you start, one approach is you take SSRIs, right, or MAO inhibitors to try to affect your mood in spite of that it's dark, so you got no vitamin D, and it's dark, so you got no serotonin cycle. If it's dark all the time, your serotonin stays cycled down. Mm. It never cycles up and says it's time to wake up. So, you can sit there and try to beat yourself over the head with hammers and crowbars and cheater bars, or you can just move where it's light and warm.
Mm.
So, part of this is just common sense. You look at the things that you can affect, and if your organism is in the wrong place to thrive, you move, for God's sake.
True.
Because taking drugs for long periods of time is just, it's bad.
Yeah. And for those of you out there who don't know what SSRIs and MAO inhibitors are, we're talking about the general category of antidepressants. So
The way they work is pretty simple. You can sum it up.
Yes.
SSRI stands for serotonin reuptake inhibitor. So what happens is when your serotonin is circulating around and being used in your system, it breaks down and the components are reuptaken or, reabsorbed. And so an SSRI aims to disrupt the enzymatic process that breaks down the serotonin and reuptakes it. So it's a poor man's, if you got a little serotonin, the cheap trick that SSRIs try to play is you break or block the process or inhibit the process that breaks those down so that the serotonin, what little you got, builds up in your system. Same way with MAO inhibitors. Most of the antipsychotics and antidepressant sort of drugs work by attempting to take what little of some substance you've got and deferring the process that breaks that down and recycles it.
Mm.
I mean, it's really stupid technology. Way better to, you know, at a first starting point, take the Eastern approach of just flooding your system with all the components to build lots of hormones and neurotransmitters, and you're pretty much done at that point, unless you live someplace where it's dark, 6 months out of a year, and then there's more trouble.
Yeah. Well, it almost sounds too like one of the systems is almost like a taking away or a deprivation, like blocking something, and another one is feeding or bringing more energy, more light, more power into the equation.
And you know, probably a good thing to mention to people too is like serotonin, norepinephrine, phenylalanine, tyrosine, all these substances that affect moods, whether they're hormones or neurotransmitters, are there's a specific equation that builds them. And so the equation is, you start with a precursor, which would be some sort of material that's got a very broad spectrum of nutrients, like cacao or chocolate, guarana or guarana, the way gringos call it, yerba mate, rhodiola. I mean, there's all sorts of different vanilla is a really complex precursor also, high grade unprocessed vanilla. So you start with a precursor, and then you add to that metabolic enzymes, which are, you can think about the precursors is like if you're thinking about a master painting a masterpiece on a canvas, is the precursors are the paints. The metabolic enzymes are the painter. That's the one doing the work. So metabolic enzymes are produced by people's pancreas. Only problem is that your pancreas can only produce metabolic enzymes if it ain't doing other things it's not supposed to be doing. Right. So what your pancreas is supposed to be doing is producing metabolic enzymes. What it's usually doing is digesting the crap people put in their mouths. Crap means continually reducing attitude and performance. Crap foods produce crap lives.
I love that analogy. It's great.
If you're eating foods that require your pancreas to be constantly involved in dealing with them, then, metabolic enzymes getting generated. So first you got the precursors, it's a paint, metabolic enzymes that are the painter. Vitamin C you can kind of think about as the brush that is actually guiding the paints the painter's using to put the paint onto the canvas. And so vitamin C means honest to gosh real vitamin C. It don't mean ascorbic, anything that's got ascorb in front of it, the ascorbic acid or this kind of ascorbate or that kind of ascorbate. Those are synthetic vitamin C's that block uptake of real vitamin C. So if you'd like to get in a real bad jam with your mood, you eat a bunch of vitamin C supplements.
Well, ascorbic acid is also, that's a preservative as well.
Yeah, I started to say, you eat any kind of processed food that uses any kind of ascorbate as a preserving agent, which there are in everything. And then the last piece of the equation are essential fatty acids, which you can think about is the canvas. So the canvas is what you're going to build your painting on. And so the canvas is basically the residual painting that you have after the process, the neurotransmitter or hormone. The bulk of it is the essential fatty acid canvas that everything's painted on. So that means if you're eating one of these quack low-fat diets, then you're going to be depressed too. Mm-hmm. Now, when I say, it's the same thing about a quack high-fat diet. If you're living on fast foods, that's just as bad as trying to go, zero fat.
Right.
So, once you understand that equation, you make sure you got precursors, your pancreas is involved with what it's supposed to be producing metabolic enzymes, you got real vitamin C, real honest to gosh, high-quality EFAs, and you're good to go.
Awesome. Can you give us a couple examples of what some high-quality EFAs are?
Oh, yeah. In fact, I was doing an article about maca here recently for a group of guys I'm working with. And it turns out, interestingly enough, that maca, coconut, and hemp, and flax to a degree, primarily though the three, maca, coconut, hemp, are really rich in medium chain and short chain fatty acids. Now these are really interesting because they require no digestive enzyme to process. you eat them, and basically, you know, like if you eat you know, some sort of lard based or animal based fat, you got all sorts of energy that has to be expended, and digestive enzymes are, they're called digestive enzymes, really what they are is immune system products that are generated by your pancreas to deal with the crap substance a person put in their mouth, continually reducing attitude and performance. So you know, if you eat things that require huge amounts of energy, and immune sort of substances are what people call digestive enzymes, then, you know, all your energy is going towards that. If you skew more towards the short and medium chain fatty acids, then you got a lot more energy. And yeah, I ought to check on cacao too, because I would imagine that if you looked at the spectrum of cacao oils, I bet that there's a lot of short and medium chained in cacao also.
Cool.
Be my guess.
What is, when you're saying medium chain fatty acids, it's the same thing as medium chain triglycerides, right?
Right. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and triglyceride is another commonly used, it's a little bit more specific term, but a lot of people use those interchangeably, which is pretty correct.
Cool. So what's the equation of, like, what's a essential fatty acid and saturated fat, unsaturated fat, polyunsaturated, how does that all
good question. So, you know, there's this rhetoric in the marketplace that saturated fat's bad for you. So, you know, that's pretty simple. That's like saying air is bad to breathe. That's true if you're living, you know, in some place where you're breathing smog, except, you know, you ain't going to be living very long if you don't breathe air.
Yes.
It's really a stupid, you know, anytime somebody, something proceeds out of somebody's mouth that's just too simplistic, like eating fat or eating, my favorites are salt, sugar, and fat are bad for you. I got news. Without salt, sugar, fat, you know, it's a slow, well, actually, it's a fast trip to the grave. You're going to be pushing up daisies quick.
What's left after salt, sugar, and fat?
I know, that's, yeah. Well, you got amino acids. the thing about the conversation about the structure of fats, where they're talking about primarily saturated or unsaturated, really what that means is you've got the lattice of the molecule of carbon and hydrogen and all the different components that make up a molecule. And so when a fat is 100% saturated, their oxygen connected in every position an oxygen molecule can connect in. Now, that's really interesting, because in 100% saturated fats like coconut oil, what that means is if there's no place for oxygen to hook up, guess what? It never oxidizes.
True.
And so here's another thing that you can test the knowledge or competence of people talking. If you hear people say, for example, that you've got to put every oil in a dark glass, then they've immediately surfaced their intelligence. Because coconut oil is one of the few oils that you can, and I've tested this myself. I took coconut oil and put it out in the plastic PET containers that we package coconut oil in. I took it out in the middle of summer in Texas one year and left it 3 weeks out in the blazing sun.
Wow.
And so that will tell you instantly if an oil, like if I'd done that with olive oil, it would have just been rancid, and it also, olive oil probably wouldn't have interacted with PET. That's specifically why we package coconut oil in PET, because glass breaks too easy. It also costs huge amounts of, it's got a carbon footprint out the wazoo for shipping. The PET doesn't interact with oils. And so what I did, I left it out in the sun for 3 weeks, and then I tasted it. So there was no plastic taste, and the oil tasted just as pristine and delicious as it did before. There was no rancidity.
Wow, that's a great experiment.
Yeah, so, I mean, it's simple. So, you know, coconut oil is one of the few things you can leave coconut oil out on your counter for years, and it'll never oxidize, because there's no way for it to oxidize. It won't photooxidize from light, and it won't oxidize from air, from air aspiration, because there's no place for oxygen to hook up. So really what you're looking for, the highest quality fats are the purely saturated ones. Those are the best fats. Anytime there's unsaturated fats, like an avocado, you cut an avocado in half and leave it out for an hour and it's brown or black.
Right.
That's the oxygen hooking up that's causing rust on the surface of the avocado where you cut it.
So is there a correlation between like a medium chain triglyceride, coconut, and unsaturated, or excuse me, saturated?
You know, that's a good question. I suspect there probably is, because if I think about things like, you know, hemp seeds and their well, hemp oil is a little bit more fragile than some oils. I've never worked with maca oil, but I know hemp seeds in their normal form and maca in its normal form tends to last for a long time just with in open air. I haven't set them out light to see if they, you know, rancidify and if they photooxidize. I'm really big. I just don't believe anybody. I just test stuff. If, you know, if somebody says, oh, you know, this oil is bad, you know, you got to package coconut oil in dark glass because it's, you know, photooxidizes and air oxidizes. Well, the first thing I'm thinking about, well, coconut oil is very different. I'm going to test it.
Right.
I'll listen to people and they'll give me experiments and I'll do my own experiments and I'll find out what's true or false. And I recommend everybody do that themselves. Don't believe anything anybody says. Figure out a set of experiments that'll give you the data you require and then run your experiments.
Yeah, it's trust but verify.
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah.
And I'd say even listen and verify.
Yes. Take the piece of information and test it, whatever, however, and yes. I love the analogy you used with the building blocks and the paint and the canvas and all that. It's very helpful to have the visual picture in building the pathway, so to speak, or the, you know, the synthesis from starting point, from basic to more complex.
Well, it's so also interesting, like if you think about, like if your pancreas is stressed out and you can produce no painters, you can have all the paints and the best canvas and the best brushes, and if ain't no painters showing up for work, you ain't gonna get no painting. So it's interesting to think in terms of all the contributions or all the components that are required to produce some substance in your body. Pretty cool.
So what would you say is a really good, someone who is either experiencing some sort of depression or anxiety or any down and out depressed, which is an interesting word, mm-hmm. to say the least, pressed down by something. Yeah, depressed feeling. What would you say is one of the easy solutions they can implement on a daily basis to achieve long-term results?
Well, if you think about the sensation of depression, it's really a compression or a contraction, a collapsing of a person's bioelectric field in some way. And so, you know, the simple things are to figure out what your consciousness or your physicality is collapsing away from or contracting away from, and figure out ways to protect yourself. For example, simple things you can do is go to your local academy or, you know, Walmart, whatever sports equipment store there is around you, and go back to the gun shop. And in the hearing protection section of your gun shop, it gets you some big honking. That's a technical term, big honking. I've been watching Justified here recently.
Sounds like Texas term.
I'm back to the hillbilly ways, boy. Anyway, so I apologize. So you get some big honking hearing protection, big noise blocking headphones, and also get some of the orange hexagonal earplugs made by Silencio. And I recommend you get them at a gun shop, because if you go to a drugstore, you'll pay, like, I've seen them as high as $10 for a pair of foam rubber plugs. And I buy them, I buy these boxes. I'll show you the boxes I buy.
Yeah.
So one of the technologies I use a lot is, you can hear the dogs barking there.
Oh, yeah.
Getting wild. Wow. So one of the technologies that I use the most is hearing protection. So I get these boxes like this. I mean, they're pretty big boxes there. I think they're 100 pairs. Let's see if it says here. Yeah, 100 pairs. And this box cost me $30. So what's... So 30 divided by 100 is what, 33. So 30 cents a pair instead of $10 a pair.
Wow. Right?
So, you know, one of the things that will depress you the worst is having an empty bank account. I recommend you do things to keep your bank account full. So hearing protection, if you look at the research on hearing, different estimates put the amount of energy that we use up on a regular basis based on auditory processing sounds as any place from 40 to 60% of our total energy. Because we're more hearing based than visual based.
Wow.
And so rule of thumb is, if you'd like to recapture a huge amount of energy and also make sure that you sleep well, put in foam rubber earplugs at night. Cut off that auditory input that requires a huge amount of energy to process. Now, that, I mean, that's a really dirt simple 30 cents for a pair of earplugs. Or you can usually get them at the gun shop for, I think last time I got some, they were like $4 or $5 for a half dozen or a dozen pairs. Just go get those and use those to cut off the noises that are entering your auditory system at night. Because if you can actually sleep is where we primarily generate all these substances, all the neurotransmitters and hormones. So that, I guess that's the other thing is that, you know, if you're thinking about a painter painting a masterpiece, you wouldn't necessarily think of them sitting on a freeway with one hand on the canvas dodging traffic while they try to paint. That's no good.
True. Very true.
Yeah, I mean, you'd normally think that they're in a quiet studio or on a beautiful rolling landscape. And so, you know, make sure the environment where you're painting has to be appropriate environment also.
Got it.
So that's cool. Also make sure it's dark where you're sleeping.
Yep.
And also make sure that your head is a long way away from EMF, electromagnetic fields. Mm-hmm. So, you know, if you have a television in your room and you're watching TV, I wouldn't recommend that. But if you do, unplug the TV before you go to sleep. Hmm. If it's really cold, you use electric blanket, warm your bed up, and then unplug it. When I lived way up north, I worked for several years contracting, and I would heat up my bed with an electric blanket, but then I'd unplug it before I actually got in. I wouldn't get inside an electric blanket running with that huge EMF all over my body.
While you're sleeping, yeah.
Oh, man, that's just freakishly odd. Same way with clock radios. I mean, clock radios, if you put an EM meter on a clock radio, some of those suckers will have a 4-foot bubble. I mean, so if you got a clock radio sitting by your head and it's irradiating your head all night, you know, in the Army, the PSYOPS programs that the military has, the two primary technologies they use to drive people crazy when they're running a PSYOP on them is low-frequency EMF. They put low-frequency EMF generators all over the person's house and drop them psychotropics to keep them awake. So mild stimulants so that people can't sleep. So, you know, if you'd like to be depressed all the time, interrupt your sleep. So the first thing, you know, top priority, if you've got some sort of anxiety or depression or psychotic breaks going on, you know, first thing is make sure you're sleeping deep.
Interesting.
Yeah. And then, you know, the next thing would be to use some sort of lymphatic cleanser to make sure your lymphatic system's cleaned out so you're not waking up from backed up lymph. And then upgrade your, you know, what you eat, drink, and breathe. And just, you know, basically you just go through and upgrade everything that is even the least downscale. And, you know, that you bring your body into homeostasis and you'll be good. Or homeostasis means balance. And,
yes,
you know, you'll all be good. So, I mean, that's the primary thing is you got to make sure you're sleeping well and you're you're eating foods that satisfy quick and for long periods of time. Mm. And if you're always hungry, that means what you're eating ain't food for you.
Right.
It might be food for somebody else, might be food for you at a different time in your life, but it ain't food now.
So find what works as far as food intake goes.
Yeah, rule of thumb is, you know how well you're nourished by the number of hours you forget to eat. Hmm. So, you know, if you, you know, eat, like I drink a couple of quarts of chocolate every day and eat one small meal a day usually. And I'm good to go.
Nice.
So, you know, find things that, you know, you can eat a little bit of and they satisfy you really quick.
Mm.
And satisfy so for
smaller
a period
meals.
Of time. Pardon me?
You're saying more like smaller meals then? Like if you are going to do like a snack, maybe like a handful of nuts or something?
Yeah, well, not necessarily so much smaller meals, more nutrient-dense, calorie-sparse.
Hmm.
Like, you know, if you're having a soft drink and a bag of Cheetos, there's a lot of calories there, buddy.
Oh, yeah.
and there's no nourishment.
Yes.
Right? So that's, a good way to stay fat and depressed is, you know, live on crap foods. Continue reducing attitude and performance.
Got it. So upgrade your food, number one.
Yeah. And, focus on your food and your sleep. Those are the big ones. Yeah.
Got it.
And then
so
go through that neurotransmitter formula and make sure that you're, you know, you got your canvas set up in a environment conducive to painting, and you got your paints and your canvas and your painter and your brush, and you're good to go.
Got it. So let's just review that cycle of the, or the analogy, or the painter you talked about, right? So having the building blocks. Okay, so starting with the basic building blocks for neurotransmitters, mm-hmm. having vitamin C for conversion,
right?
Being in the correct environment, and then the EFAs.
Mm-hmm.
Can you give us an example of one of those pathways, like select a specific
that's a good point too, because each one of the precursors that you start with, the end point of the equation becomes the next precursor. For example, there is no dietary serotonin. There is no dietary dopamine, right? You can't go out and pick a fruit and eat it to get dopamine.
Right.
Or serotonin. It ain't going to work. What you can do, though, is you can eat foods that are rich in tryptophan.
Mm-hmm.
So basically, one precursor that plugs in the equation, goes all the way through the equation, and produces some substance. That substance plugs back in the other end. So for example, I just remember the exact sequence, whether dopamine or I think probably serotonin would come first, because it's a shorter molecule. So
I believe it does.
So yeah. Tryptophan, you go through the equation, you produce serotonin. Serotonin plugs back in, goes through the equation, produces dopamine. Dopamine comes back in and probably produces some more rare substances that are concentrated in the pineal and pituitary, but more than mm-hmm. likely, I would guess. So what that means also is that if you miss one of those precursors that are dietary precursors, none of the other internally synthesized compounds are ever created.
So what's something that's a high source of tryptophan besides, you know, turkey?
Well, so tryptophan, really, really good sources of tryptophan are cacao is a good source, because it's got a lot of other ingredients that synergize to make the tryptophan more powerful.
Mm.
Really dense tryptophan is found in edamame beans, durian. I mean, durian's off the hooks full of tryptophan.
Nice.
I suspect, especially if you're making nut milks, nuts and seeds have a fair amount of tryptophan.
Mm.
And if you make nut milk, I suspect that, by changing the fiber ratio and emulsifying the tryptophan and fats in the liquid, that the assimilable tryptophan goes up.
Cool.
So, we're surrounded by tryptophan. Yeah, I mean, here's another way you can test people's intelligence. If they say turkey is the best source of tryptophan, then you can put them in the stupid pot. They're obviously about as bright as a bag of hammers. And the problem with eating turkey is, it's true that turkey's got a lot of tryptophan, but the problem with eating animal foods, both the milk products and the flesh, is that it drives pH so acid that, you know, that's back to having the environment that's conducive to have a painting painted. If your system is very acidic all the time, or constantly being driven acidic, that's like trying to paint on the freeway. You're dodging 18 wheelers all the time.
Mm.
And so what you're looking for is your eating style or dietary intake to facilitate staying in a fairly narrow band where you're fairly alkaline most of the time.
Cool.
Yep.
And what would you say is a good EFA or essential fatty acid to add into that mix there, something to focus on?
Well, I mean, really good sources of EFAs are that are dirt cheap too would be the seeds, golden flax, chia. Chia are really good. You can get, like, we sell chia for, I think, $20 a pound or something like that. Or you can buy the trade name like Milan Salba. You know, each one of those dumps it up, like, it goes to $40 a pound for, I think, Salba, and Mila is 60.
Wow.
$60 a pound they charge for chia.
Wowzers.
So that's another thing, you know, if you'd like to be depressed with an empty bank account, you know, buy into all these packaging trade names. Chia seeds. I mean, I know where these guys get all their product, and it's from the same place we get ours.
Yep.
It ain't like they got special chia fields, for the, you know, the Mila people. No. Independent of what they do, they will tell you that. Oh, yes, yeah. We've got a special field. Yeah, right. That's right next door to the other field. They just, you know, put a sign on it that says, this is Mila. Anyway, golden flax, hemp seeds, chia seeds, coconut products. Just make sure that avoid most coconut flours because they're mislabeled. Most coconut flours say 100% and they're just chock full of milk and sugar. Coconut products, maca is a really good source of it, really dense medium chain and short chain fatty acids.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Cool.
So, awesome. I mean, yeah, most of the ingredients in Chocolate Bliss are one of the components. Even things like rhodiola have a very interesting fatty acid complex because they're a tuber just like maca.
Yeah.
Rhodiola is kind of the Asian equivalent to maca.
Very cool.
It's kind of cool. Yeah.
It is very cool. Ooh, I like that. Awesome.
Yeah.
Well, thanks for all that. I mean, that was some great information there. And maybe give a brief synopsis of how anybody could acquire any of those materials you mentioned, radicalhealth.com or...
Yeah, or you should be selling our stuff and they should be buying it from you. Oh!
Oh,
so you can get in touch with me at Radical Health if you'd like to try out some of our superfoods. We import ingredients from all over the world and package them together and ship them out, the final product, back out all over the world. So
excellent, fantastic, and I can attest they are fantastic products. They're one of my favorites around. So awesome. Thank you, David, for being with us today and for offering all this information. And all of you watching this video today, I hope you enjoyed everything we had to say. If you have any questions, you can leave your comments or go to Health Happens Naturally, write us, say stuff, comment, say hello, ask your questions.
Cool. Thanks, Jeffrey.
Awesome. Take care, buddy.
You bet.